Yes, I love it.
Each retrofit is unique.
The sky's the limit. So.
Awesome.
They sold out. Utilities were next to zero.
I have a boiler now, and I have radiant hydronic. I will actually be able to replace my entire boiler system with a heat pump.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
Very exciting.
The majority of our inquiries are from homeowners, so homeowners are really motivated to get away from gas.
A lot of contractors, not everybody, but a lot of contractors don't believe that gas is either going away or should go away.
My name is Eric Kaiser, and I work for True Tech Tools, and we are an online tool distributor. HVAC is kind of the conditioning piece of the house, where the building performance is working on the shell of the house, but those two work together really well, because in houses and buildings, we have to have a good shell in order to condition the inside. My boss likes to say, the building contains the expensive air that the HVAC makes.
How would you describe what it takes to do a proper energy audit of a new build?
So a new build, you need to start with the plans and how it was laid out originally.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to make sure that the way that it was designed or the way that it's built actually meets the way that it's designed.
Yes.
So you need to look at the designer. Okay, how tight did they specify the house?
Yeah.
How tight did they want everything sealed up? Then you start measuring the things like ventilation. You start measuring things like airflow going into different rooms, coming in or out of the house in the ventilation areas. So you're going to need airflow testing equipment. If it's a freshly built house, maybe we want to walk around and look at it with a thermal camera to make sure that all the insulation was put in. Now, hopefully, maybe somebody did a pre-drywall inspection or something like that to check that, because it's much harder to fix insulation after the drywall and things like that are up. So we want to get that done right the first time, shall we say. So you need a variety of tools.
Matt Baker, I'm the manager of energy efficiency and electrification program development here at Daikin. So I have a team of folks that focus strictly on high efficiency programs, electrification programs across the country. Our job is really to understand what all those programs are and communicate them to our sales channels. What programs are available, what rebates are available, how do you participate in those programs, which of our equipment qualifies. It's all about increasing participation from contractors in programs. We're kind of unique in that not a lot of other manufacturers invest in this way and have a team of folks that are focused on these types of programs, but that's really in line with the Daikin vision. We are a manufacturer, largest global manufacturer of HVACR equipment, but we're very, very focused on heat pumps, specifically high efficiency inverter-driven variable capacity heat pumps. So these are the highest efficiency that today's technology allows for.
Thank you again for sponsoring the conference. Very much appreciated and taking the time to talk with me. Thank you.
You bet. Thanks so much.
The whole industry is going through a transition. We are doing a lot of educating builders, installers, and homeowners. We're actually getting a majority of our inquiries are from homeowners. So homeowners are really motivated to get away from gas. And then they take that information that we provide to their installers, to their builders, and say, hey, this is what I want to build.
Each retrofit is unique, but generally they're the same in that it's, you know, PEX tubing and concrete or PEX tubing.
Okay, but from your point, like from the products you supply, there's probably like size options,
right? Yeah.
And that's it, right?
Three sizes.
Okay, three sizes.
Yeah.
Okay. And in terms of oversizing, because that was very interesting, and I also got comments from contractors that would actually love to size it appropriately. And we had this discussion, right? That there is a should be a cutoff, and then actually should be supplemental heating in a lot of cases. But what ends up happening is they just cover the extremes and oversize the systems, right?
In most of our systems, we're actually undersizing them. For one reason is that heat pumps are still more expensive than boilers, so we're trying to keep the cost down. But it does not necessarily make sense to right size a heat pump. If you look at the weather pattern, the extreme hours, temperature hours in a year, there's only a handful of them. And so if you were to size the heat pump for those extreme hours, the heat pump would be oversized 95% of the year. And so sizing it for the 90 or 95th percentile, then you're still getting a very efficient system, and then you have a small backup, low cost backup that is able to provide heat during that extreme, those extreme hours. And that saves the homeowner quite a bit of money up front. It adds a little bit on the operating side, but if we are designing it properly, then it's only a handful of hours and really doesn't show up.
Okay. And we tell the customer how many hours that's going to be.
Yeah. Okay.
So that
you tell the customer.
Yeah. So that they're not surprised when they get their electricity bill. They know that what to expect.
Okay. Exactly. Our analysis is always very clear what your expected performance is going to be. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we calculate if you're converting from a propane, we tell you your heating bills are going to go down to a half or a third with a heat pump, or with natural gas, what you can expect, and so forth. Yeah, if you're looking to generate your own electricity using a PV system, we tell you what size that would need to be in order to compensate for your the electricity consumption of your heat pump system.
Okay, wonderful.
It's not rocket science. It's established technology that's been around for a long time, and we just need to make sure that it's applied properly. That is pretty much a guarantee for happy homeowners.
Denver Capitol Building has a heat pump. It's been there for 100 years, so it's a very known technology.
First of all, I'm a building science geek, right? So my first love is building sustainable housing that is not only resilient, but also helps add value to the homeowner and also helps build generational wealth. Because if we build homes like we typically have, that 30 years later, after you pay the mortgage, have to be basically demolished and rebuilt from ground up, that doesn't build any kind of generational wealth. And I come from Europe where, I grew up in a home that was I was a third generation that grew up in the same home. And if we can do it in a third world poor country, we can absolutely do it here in the United States. Well, we have the technology, we have the resources, we have the willpower to do so, right? Our newest offering right now also, which is our monoblock system, that is great, not just for new construction, but we're just now starting to stock up our warehouses in the US with it. But it's think of it like a mini chiller, but for residential application. It cools, it heats, but all I'm moving from outside into my home is water. If there's an issue, if there's a leak, not only is it cheap and easy to repair, but it's also not anything toxic that I'm bringing into my home.
We are in the market now with Anesi gas heat pumps. Anesi is another word for comfort, and it's a gas heat pump. It runs on thermal energy. I said to the engineers, well, so what is this thing good for? What do you think it would work with? And they said, well, we think it could run a gas absorption chiller. And I said, what's a gas absorption chiller? I'd never heard of such a thing.
If it's that new, you have to work your way through a lot of buy-ins on all sides, on the demand side, on the supply side. In the US, the heat pump market is catching up in general, so there's a lot of education to do on all ends, full stop. But then you kind of come in and have another component that is different from what the whole industry is doing.
Right. The good news is that we've already established a pretty good foothold in the marketplace through a lot of HVAC contractors and the independent manufacturers reps who are kind of the backbone to this industry. We are fully represented throughout North America in the climates in the zones that we want to be in, which is all of Canada and almost all of North America in terms of particularly the warmer or the colder climates where we want to be. I don't think we'd have that kind of signed representation if we didn't have a product that people who've been in this industry for a long time were interested in. The way it works is that what Carre figured out was that ammonia and water are very attracted to each other. They dissolve with each other. If you heat it up, the ammonia has the lower boiling point between the water and the ammonia. It's going to boil off first. So you have it rising to the surface out of this cylinder, what we call a desorber. And it's literally the water and the ammonia desorbing, separating. The ammonia boils off first. Exothermic reaction. This is one of the things that Ferdinand Carre figured out back in 1859. The ammonia wants to instantly dissolve into the water. It's exothermic. It's going to give off some heat in that process. That now reunited ammonia and water are going to get delivered back to the desorber where the heat is, and they're going to restart the cycle all over again. The ammonia gets boiled off and heads off again. That's the cycle.
Your sample bid for a 5-zone split air source heat pump system. What's your price? That's excellent. Everybody take a note.
I feel kind of fortunate to be in the Front Range of Colorado. Net zero communities, electrification, grid resiliency, and that involves residential communities from new construction to retrofitting existing homes. I recommend not being the late lagger in this phase of the industry. I don't personally believe that's going to work out too well.
The lead general contractor and a real estate investor initiated the community. I was brought in as the energy consultant, very much in the planning stages, because the project went for Energy Star, LEED, Indoor Air Quality Plus, Net Zero Ready, you know, all of these above code programs that take a lot of coordination and energy modeling and overlapping, sometimes conflicting requirements. And so that was a maze to navigate before construction started. Our main focus for that project was to get our HERS score down in the 40s, you know, lower 40s to mid 40s before we started modeling for renewable energy.
Mm-hmm.
That was achieved by using geothermal heat pumps. They were well-drilled geothermal because it was a relatively high-density community, so there wasn't space to go out so much. So we drilled wells and had properly sized geothermal systems for each home. Water-to-air heat pumps, inducted systems. So the interesting part, you know, is other than the geothermal well-drilling part, you know, the HVAC contractors knew how to do all of the standard installation already. That wasn't foreign to them, and they really didn't have an issue with it. You know, I think they kind of enjoyed being on that progressive edge and being a part of a community that was pushing the boundary and going for net zero.
Rationally, there's like, it's a no-brainer, essentially.
I agree with you.
I'm Daniel Hillegas. I work with TM Sales based out of Denver, Colorado. We are the manufacturer's rep for A.O. Smith State and American heat pump water heaters for both, we've got Colorado, Wyoming, and Montana as far as our sales territory.
So. Oh, wonderful. Yeah. So what's your experience in this area? So you use them both for air to water and geothermal?
In this case, most of ours are going to be air to water. We do have a commercial offering that does water to water. But in this case, yes, we're actually using ambient air temperature, scrubbing that heat into the refrigerant. And then we use, in essence, the condenser is going to be wrapped around the side of the tank. And that's what transfers in to make our domestic hot water. So
okay.
My background on these, you know, being plumbing on this side, personally, I come from the HVAC side. So knowing about the refrigerant cycle and how that kind of works has definitely helped me out with this. But it definitely makes sense. If you think an AC condenser is just scrubbing that heat off into the exterior in the summertime, why can't we utilize that hot refrigerant to make hot water? So
okay,
makes sense. Mm-hmm.
How many of these did you sell?
Oh gosh, in this case, it's finally picking up, especially as we've gotten more adoption for these things. But we've gone from, you know, in the last couple of years to selling a handful here and there to now we're getting up into the hundreds that we're actually getting out there.
Okay.
We're also getting some traction on new construction, which is something that's new, that's kind of different for us. But yeah, these are not going away. And obviously because of legislative changes that have just recently even been announced, these are going to be it when you talk about electric heaters coming in 2029. So the sky's the limit. So.
Awesome. Yeah. So you're at the right place, the right time.
Absolutely. I think we're trying to, we have a very diverse setup when it comes to the heat pump offering, all the way up into commercial, down to the residential stuff. So we're getting into all those different parts of the business here. So, but kind of our deal is if somebody says that they need hot water, the answer is yes.
Right. So that's one of the things where it comes to customer education, because oftentimes the mass market is obviously air to air, and then often people miss out on the opportunity of using water as a thermal battery and thermal storage. So what's your experience there? Is it easy to make clear to customers? And that's obviously then not what you're doing, because you're working with the builder who then makes the recommendation, right?
In many cases, so the people that we talk to the most are going to be not only our professional wholesalers that actually carry the product, but then their contractors, their customers.
Okay.
That is me personally, what I target as my target audience are the contractors. So the folks that are either calling, hearing about the heat pumps, I get notifications. I'm a customer of our utility provider that gets notifications like, hey, did you know we got rebate money involved with this?
Yeah.
So when they pick up the phone and call the contractor, it's very important to me that that contractor knows everything about these so that they can ask all the appropriate questions, make sure it's going to be the right fit for those folks. The last thing we want to do is have somebody install one of these things and then it works perfectly, but the end user doesn't like how it works.
Doesn't like
it.
Okay.
So there is no more efficient way to make hot water than a heat pump.
This is the condensed version of about 4 hours of recording at the Heat Pump Summit. Any takeaways? Anything that you'd recommend for the next conference recording? Let me know in the comments. By the way, it also helps out with the YouTube algorithm. Thank you very much for watching. Have a great time and see you in the next one. Bye.
Thank you. Awesome.
How do we look?
It's not the optimal lens. Yeah.
Getting ready for my close-up. So. You got any questions?
Loading you with lots of questions here at the same time. But
that's a very loaded question right there. How long is this? We could be here for a couple hours.
So, we got 2 hours. Go.
Just call.